welcome everybody to our memoir reading, the library's memoir workshop. I want to just start by thanking some very special people. Thank you to Meg Salowitz at the library for making the space available to us and making it's a wonderful home that we have here, and we all feel very cozy, and it's really great. We could write a lot of testimony about how great it is to work together here. Also to Emily Bartram, who's sitting on the stairwell there, also a librarian here, and thank you for all the sort of prep work that you do with us every time we meet. Thank you to the library, which is so beautiful, and you know, there aren't many structures like this anymore in Sharon or elsewhere that have this kind of history and this kind of impracticality, which is really quite grand. We're now mourning the fact that the old water tank has been removed, apparently. So, you know, things were really in their pristine state, but actually, thanks to Meg, a lot of improvements are being made. So I want to also thank Catherine Kiefer, who's taken the photographs for us each year. And the beautiful photograph on Passages is by Catherine. And to Shirley Zimmerman, who has made the programs for us. And of course to Meg and Emily for getting the postcards out and the posters out and so on. So here is a little bit about the readings. One of the things you'll notice is that several of the pieces say excerpts. Now that really wouldn't have been possible last year even, because people were still writing short pieces. But this year, a number of the members of the workshop began to write really long pieces. And so what could be read was an excerpt. So I think that's one of the amazing pieces of progress of the workshop, that people have gotten more ambitious. I think most of the writers in the workshop are actually working on very, very long, probably book-length works. As you'll notice, when you listen to the workshop readings, the voices are completely different. The topics are completely different. There's no one voice at all. And I think one of the great things about the workshop is how we've all been able to appreciate each other's voices and each other's very, very different experiences. If anybody has a question, otherwise, I think we'll begin. Oh, let me just say that in the first part, we'll begin with an early memoir, a memoir of an early time in someone's life, and then go on to some memoirs of the 70s, and then finally to, this is before the intermission, and finally to a section of Amanda Roberts' reading will be on her mother's memoirs, and you'll talk about that.
Yes.
I don't want to say, if I may, one quick thing. Why do we do this? We write memoirs to better understand the events that have shaped us, how it is we have become what we are. Mine is called The Beginning of the End.
Can you hear back there?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Is it okay? Mm-hmm. September 3rd, 1939 was, as I remember, a sunny day. I had turned 12 the day before, and my sister Jillian was 9. We were standing by the gate to the orchard when our father approached. He said, "We have just declared war on Germany." I knew we had issued an ultimatum to Germany, demanding their withdrawal from the Danzig corridor. Even so, my heart sank. I had a premonition of what was to come. "Doom," said my heartbeat. We had often listened to important announcements on the radio, the death of George V, the abdication of Edward VIII, and felt a connection to the royal family, since the two princesses, Margaret Rose and Elizabeth, were the same age as Jillian and I. 3 months later, we sat around the radio and listened to the King's Christmas Day speech. We knew he struggled to avoid stammering, and our hearts were with him. He concluded, "And I said to the man who stood at the gate of the year, give me a light that I may tread safely into the unknown." And he replied, "Go out into the darkness and put your hand into the hand of God. That shall be to you better than the light and safer than the known way." When I was 5, we had moved from London into the Hampshire countryside. We lived in a cottage in the village of North Walnor near Odeon. The phone number, Odeon48, is now my email. Our parents had painted the long red brick bungalow a soft shade of pink. At first, there was no electricity. We relied on oil lamps whose wicks needed constant trimming, and fireplaces and kerosene stoves for heating. The house was surrounded by gardens, and in front was an apple orchard and a large field. Behind the house was a thatched open summer house, and at the top of the field, a stable with 3 stalls. We had our ponies, my sister's a Welsh pony, Sox, and mine a New Forest pony, Cor. We were allowed to go off riding by ourselves in the nearby common and in the forest of Butterwood. Every winter, our parents went fox hunting at least once a week with the Hampshire Hunt. And by the time I was 12, I had already joined them several times. My mother tended the flowers in front of the house, including a special rock garden with plants gathered from the Alps, and my father took pride in his vegetable garden. There was a groom, Pilby, 2 gardeners, Milam and White, 2 Irish maids, Kathleen and Gladys, and a governess. We had started with German governesses, but as war threatened, they were replaced with French ones. Both my sister could and did often converse in 3 languages. Every morning our father left for the city, traveling by train, about a 1-hour journey from the nearby station of Hook. He was dressed for the city in a suit, bowler hat, umbrella, and always a boutonniere. I remember violets. When he came back at the end of the day, he wandered around the vegetable garden with Milam, an old man who had fought in the Boer War. My father had also built a small greenhouse and grew scented cyclamen and violets. Our parents were somewhat distant. They left our upbringing to the nannies and governesses. We seldom ate with them in the dining room. Our meals were prepared separately and served in the nursery. I do have memories of my mother coming to kiss us goodnight before she left for the party and leaning over us with her perfume, Fleur de Rocaille, I believe. I never remember being read to until I went to school, and there were few books in the house. When I turned 10, Gillian and I were sent off to a day school in Basingstoke. We traveled there by steam train, a journey of perhaps 30 minutes from the station in nearby Hook. The following year, we were off to boarding schools, Gillian to Litchett Manor in Dorset, and I to Brickwall in Northiam, Kent, which you may know is the site of Great Dixter, the famous English garden. The school, which still exists, was a lovely Jacobean manor attached to a huge deer park. Brickwall was progressive and a good choice for me. We wore uniforms of brown shorts, knee socks, and red sweaters in winter, and blue Airtech shirts and shorts in summer. There were ponies, and we went riding. And as it was all girls, we went skinny dipping in the pond. I remember being able to roast chestnuts gathered in the park on the fireplace in the common room. There were art classes that I enjoyed. But on that day, September 1939, school had not yet started. Changes happened fast,
as the possibility of not only air raids, but of a German invasion loomed. I went with my father to help fill sandbags to be placed around the village hall. Shop windows were crisscrossed with tape. We were issued gas masks in little cardboard boxes. There were very strict blackout regulations. Our father became an air raid warden, and it was his job to go around the village every evening and make sure nobody was showing even a chink of light. Rationing went into effect. When we went to London, huge grey barrage balloons filled the sky, looking like giant floating elephants. They were tethered to the ground by wires and were designed to deter low-flying aircraft from attacking the city. Signposts, as well as names of train stations, were taken down to make it more difficult for invaders to find the way. The following spring, my mother decided to use money that she had inherited from our great aunt Emily and take my sister and me to Bermuda via Canada for the duration of the war. On June 30th, 1940, we embarked from Liverpool in the Duchess of Richmond, crowded with adults and children, evacuees. We crossed the Atlantic in a convoy with a destroyer, Wanderer, circling the group of ships. The danger from German U-boats was very real. The captain, who never left the bridge, told my mother that she had realized the danger, she would not have made the crossing. We had to carry our heavy cork life jackets with us at all times. I saw an iceberg in the early morning light and a whale. A year or two later, another ship, the city of Benares, was torpedoed and sank with the loss of many children. The British government stopped the program of evacuating children to Canada. It all happened, much as I had feared, on that September day. My father joined the artillery as a captain, but was invalided out because of a heart condition. Our parents' marriage, like so many other marriages, was a casualty of the war. Our home, Derby Fields, was sold. Both of our ponies died, and Gillian and I ended up making our lives in this country. Years later, I went back to look at Derby Fields. The trees in the field had died. Only a shell of rusted metal remained of my father's beloved greenhouse. My mother's rock garden was overgrown with thyme. I still dream of walking around my childhood home.
My piece is titled Goshen, 1970s. We were married in April 1967, a few months after David returned from Vietnam and was discharged from the CDs. We had been spending our weekends looking at houses in Torrington when we both discovered that neither of us wanted to live in a city. The scope of our weekend ride stretched to the small but popular and upcoming town of Harwinton, which was closer to Hartford and to Winchester, but not Winstead, which was not a far daily commute to Torrington for David. Then we heard about Woodridge Lake in Goshen. Five Goshen farmers were selling portions of adjoining properties to a land development corporation which planned to build homes on lots. Once I realized the difference between a lot and an acre, I looked at David and said, "No way, I'll definitely feel like a sardine, and I don't want to be told what I can and cannot do in my own yard." He agreed. He also needed more space. David's background was carpentry, which he had learned at Oliver Wolcott Technical School and continued as a CV. He had recently started working for his father in the family moving business, and although I worked full-time at Southern New England Telephone Company, I didn't plan on working after we had children. We were both family-oriented. David was the sixth of nine children, and I was the eldest of six surviving siblings. We knew not to expect, nor did we want, any financial assistance from our families. We were both independent and excellent savers, and by 1970 had saved enough money to pay cash for our Goshen property. Since my dad had been a mason to supplement my family's coffers, we asked him if he would build a fireplace in our home, and he agreed. Once again, although for a different reason, David and I spent weekends riding the back roads of Northwest Connecticut in Dad Bonaguy's borrowed dump truck in search of stones, rocks, and boulders for the magnificent fireplace that we dreamed of. I coordinated my days off at SNAP with my father's days off so I could be his masonry gopher. I don't know how many bags of cement I mixed by hand over the next year, or how many shovels of sand I added to the cement soup. I would also shift piles of stones so that he could get a good look at each stone's face before chipping at it with his trowel, then carefully placing it onto the wet cement next to the already placed stone. Over the next few years on future masonry jobs, he would have several helpers, including my brothers, but my dad always said that he liked the way I mixed cement because it always had the same consistency. In June of 1971, about the time we found out that I was pregnant, I had a promotion at the phone company, which I accepted. At that time, there was no maternity leave, and we needed to save as much as we could before we had our baby. All of a sudden, Dad and David became hovering helicopter men, although the term did not come into being until the 2000s. There went the Mason gopher, or so they thought. We had our arbor home built by a brother-in-law. At 23, I knew nothing about building a house, and David was under the spell of his brother-in-law, a creative expert carpenter. Whatever he suggested or did, we readily agreed. My dad didn't always agree, and I would counter with, "He's the professional." I still toss that quote out, but now it is to my husband. Our home was absolutely a 1970s house with three bedrooms, one and a half bathrooms, a small U-shaped kitchen, all the rage, which I did not like, a dining room that we used for meals and everything else, and a large living room with my dad's fireplace right in the middle. There was a complete unpointed fireplace in the basement, and the hearth of the living room fireplace was also open to the dining room. My dream home had a cathedral ceiling and a balcony, which I demanded. After many heated debates with my husband, I sat down with my dad for his unbiased opinion. The upshot was that he would speak to my brother-in-law. Dad didn't like to use the telephone, so I knew he would drive out to the property the next day. After a sleepless night, I chastised myself for having Dad take on my responsibility. I had never overridden an authority figure's decision, and the carpenter was a professional figure, and David was my husband. At 6 a.m., I called Dad and asked if he would meet me at the job site. I would do the talking. In the end, the plans were changed to a cathedral ceiling, but no balcony, although I did receive a beautiful staircase handmade by my brother-in-law. The next step was to convince David, which wasn't as difficult as I thought it would be, thanks to my carpenter brother-in-law. David and I, along with our three-month-old daughter, moved into our uncompleted home during the ice storm of 1972. Our custom kitchen cabinets and appliances had not yet arrived. During the winter days, I stained and varnished the woodwork of the unfinished rooms so that David could complete 3 or 4 hours of trimming at night after a full day of work. David did all the wood trim, chair rail, paneling, doors, wood floors, and eventually my orange for my countertop. David's carpentry skills blossomed during each additional project. With my job at the phone company gone and without a car, I was suddenly miserable. For the first time in my life, I was and felt isolated. On sunny days after baby Christine's nap, I would push the carriage to the library, which was a mile each way. I met the neighbors. All were retired and were just waking up from their naps. I loved the baby, and they loved the baby, and she basked in their attention. Since bedtime for infant restricted our going out for the evening, on Saturday nights I invited the three elderly couples from the neighborhood to our still-in-progress home for dinner and cards. Those nights were filled with history lessons and recipes. Four neighbors were originally from Goshen and two were from Italy. The diverse backgrounds of these neighbors included farming in Italy and in Goshen, a machinist, a companion for a famous children's author, and raising children who were my age. We were experiencing the changing world of the United States in the 1970s, yet discussed Goshen and its rich history, agriculture, and agribusiness, and the families of the town. We were newbies. You didn't become a Goshenite until you lived in town for 40 years. It was 42 last January.
I'm Priscilla Pavel, and I'm still in the 70s. This is my excerpt from Adventures in the Garment Trade. After 3 years of working at McCall's Pattern Company, 46th and Park Avenue, I wanted to work for a fabric company. I loved fabrics and had always sewn my own clothes, and now that I knew the pattern part of the business, I was ready to move on. Each pattern company maintained its own fabric library, which enabled designers and stylists to view current trends when creating new patterns. New fabrics would be selected for photography and pattern front illustrations. I asked our fabric librarian if, confidentially, she would let me know if any of the fabric companies were looking for new people. My first job interview materialized within a week. The company had nice owners, and the interview went well until I viewed their fabric line. It was all synthetic, rayon, nylon, and polyester yarns made into warp knits. Though offered a position, I turned it down. McCall's fabric librarian was dismayed, as she had highly recommended me for the job. I explained to her how working at McCall's made me proud, and I wouldn't feel proud marketing fabric produced from man-made fibers. I asked the librarian to show me the product line of any other fabric companies needing a new hire before making an appointment for me. After several perusals of fabric lines, I was on my way across town to meet the people at the Wamsutta Fabric Division of M. Lowenstein and Sons. Just the trip across town from Park Avenue and 46th Street to Broadway and 40th Street was an adventure. 1430 Broadway housed First National City Bank in the lobby, and Lowenstein occupied the next seven floors. Senior Lowenstein officers were on the fourth floor. The Wamsutta division was on seven. I was interviewing for a stylist position for an over-the-counter department of Wamsutta, which produced fabric for retail stores, hence the over-the-counter label. John Gannon was director of that division, and we hit it off right away. The only problem for him was that I was married, since the position involved traveling about 20 weeks a year. But already in the second year with my husband, I knew this was not a forever marriage. Moreover, he was out of work, and we really needed the $1,500 raise this job would bring. After arguing that being married would not conflict with traveling, Mr. Gannon offered me the position and I jumped on it. An important part of the stylist's job was to view each of Wamsutta's fabric division's products and choose those that I thought would be best to offer on the bolt to retail fabric stores for home sewers. There were many divisions, and my reviews were quickly narrowed to woven solids, shirtings, and dress print goods of cotton, polycotton blends, and rayons. Each day, the various divisions delivered their newest samples to my office. My husband tells me I need to explain when this is what a typical fabric sample would be that would come in from the divisions. There were many divisions. I quickly narrowed them down, and these were the samples. I reported my selections weekly to Mr. Gannon. Once approved, I traveled downtown to the company that made our new product samples to tell them what kinds of samples we wanted to distribute to our salesmen in the field to show to their regional wholesale distributors who sold the fabric to the retail stores. At first, I was told by the division heads which supplied me with the yardage for the samples that I was using too much fabric. That ended with our first sales meeting. Our salesmen loved my samples. They were bigger, People could feel them, handle them. I offered more colors. If there were more than 12 colors of a particular print, they were presented on large folders with an 18 by 22 inch Spangler rectangle. If there were fewer than 12 colors, I would do a hanging set of fabric swatches with all the colors. Yes, it did take a lot more fabric than the 4-inch squares they were used to, but it was significantly more effective as a selling tool. I also introduced coordinating matching solid color fabrics with the new prints. That was a first, and the salesman loved it. It helped them to sell more fabric and earn larger commissions. The traveling part of the job was to attend wholesale distributor shows around the U.S. The Friday of each 3-day show weekend was for presenting our new fabric lines to the distributor salesman. Although our own company salesman with whom I worked in New York City had always done these presentations, they all warned me to do them. As a former school teacher, I loved the chance to teach salespeople the new lines. I never thought about it as a selling job. It was fun. On the second day, all the fabric vendors who had come in from New York City set up display booths in the local wholesale distributor warehouses. Local and regional fabric store owners would come in to place orders for their new lines. Usually on Saturday morning, the big event was a fashion show. Each vendor had about 20 garments made up using McCall, Simplicity, or Vogue patterns to show off their new fabrics, how the designs and prints would look in real-life garments. Each stylist would narrate her part of the show. After 6 months in this new position, I expected a salary raise. When it didn't come, I asked Mr. Gannon why I didn't get a raise, since I knew all the salesmen had received raises. He told me it was an old-fashioned firm. Since I was a married woman, I did not rate a raise. It was my first experience of being discriminated against as a woman, and I was crushed. I asked if there was something more that I should be doing to earn the raise. He said no, and assured me that there would be a good raise in 6 more months. When the raise came through, he said, I listed you as one of the salesmen with only your first initial and last name, and it worked. Although Mr. Gannon was one of the several other over-the-counter division heads who were Irish, the fabric firms were generally Jewish. At Lowenstein, the older executives always switched into a foreign language when I entered the room. It sounded a little like German to me, and so I finally inquired what it was. It was Yiddish. When Women's Wear Daily newspaper ran an ad for a conversational Yiddish class at the Workman's Circle, I signed up and took that class, but never told anyone at work. So now I knew what they were saying. It was always about the shiksa and her tukas, the Gentile girl and her rear end, or some such in a lascivious way. Probably, if they had known that they were understood, they would have been as embarrassed as I. When one of the Wamsutta salesmen moved to a new position with Venice Industries, a firm making double knit fabrics, he said, you must come over here for an interview. Moving down the block from 1430 to 1412 Broadway, my next garment center job was as a fashion coordinator for Venice Industries. They had a ready-to-wear division, a uniform division, and wanted to start an over-the-counter division selling double knit fabrics, which were all the rage in the 1970s. I was losing my aversion to synthetic fabrics. Avadik Akopians, the owner and chairman of the board of Venice Industries, had been born in Iran and educated in Paris and Venice, and had renamed himself Al Paris. Since he only produced ready-to-wear, his first question to me was, how do I sample this to the over-the-counter market? I reviewed his entire line of garments. Everything was yarn-dyed. Solids and jacquard knits, plus transfer prints, color keyed to coordinate. I asked for samples of the yarns to be delivered to my office. The next day I walked back to his office with several waterfall cap sets, each one a different colorway. Cap sets are those multiple fabrics stitched to a cardboard header. I admitted to him that no one in the industry sampled knits this way, but it seemed so logical to me because this way a store could order a perfect product line based on their color needs. He quickly agreed, and our double knits found their ways into many fabric stores within weeks of the salesman receiving the sample cap sets. His next idea, all his, was that we should open a fabric store at the end of one of his warehouses in New Jersey. I had the job of designing the layout. He also wanted me to buy thread for sewing, but only the colors that matched our knits. He then added color-coordinated buttons. Home sewers actually found their way to the warehouse. Meanwhile, Mr. Paris had his salesman drive buyers from the New York City office to show them the store. One of the great pleasures of working for Venice Industries was that a United Nations of workers was making a completely American product. The man heading the spinning plant in Long Island City was an Orthodox Jew from Eastern Europe who observed all the Jewish holidays. The head of the knitting plant was an American Jewish man. The warehouse head was a Cuban refugee, and several of the sample makers were Armenian. Another great treat was that Mr. Paris had good ideas quickly. He decided that he wanted to enter the London ready-to-wear market. He asked me to plan a fashion show that I could present three times in one day, and he hired the penthouse suite in the London Hotel. We would do a breakfast presentation, a luncheon presentation, and a cocktail presentation. I made a selection of about 20 outfits from his ready-to-wear line to show to Mr. Paris. He added a few more and had large cases custom-made so the garments could ship flat with me. I would fly first class to London with these cases 2 days ahead of the shows to hire models and to work out the menus for the three presentations. He had a limo take me to JFK, where I had to battle with Pan Am to accept my garment cases. Several hundred dollars later, Pan Am boarded my cases as freight. We finished up the shows on the Thursday about 6, and Mr. Paris announced that I could fly right back that evening if I wanted to. "No," I said, "I've never been to London before, and I've decided to stay and visit the stores and the Victoria and Albert Museum, but I'll be back in the office on Monday."
If you're interested in fabric, let her know.
But we have to buy her houses to get the fabrics. Is
that right? Hi, I'm Amanda Roberts, and I'm going to be reading two selections from a project I'm working on that I call my mother's memoirs. The first selection is the preface, which will hopefully explain the concept of the project. My mother's memoirs. My mother's memoirs, preface. My mother's memory began to fail when she was in her early 80s. Her second husband was still alive with a mind as sharp as a tack. So it wasn't really until he died in 2002 that her memory loss became a problem. In her late 80s, she became more acutely aware that there were things she no longer remembered and wanted to, quote, write my life, unquote, before she forgot it. Handwritten, single-spaced on lined paper, several drafts edited and again rewritten by hand. When my sister Claudia or I visited, we would find the papers spread out all over the bed in her small room in assisted living. We would go over them with her, try to put them in order, and reminisce as we did. The next time we visited, they would again be spread out all over the bed. She was constantly sorting them, rearranging them, trying to get them to make sense to her fading mind. Eventually, she declared them done. And over 70 pages, and let me take them home to type into the computer, doing my best to decipher both the handwriting and the sequence. They made perfect sense if I let my mind fill in the gaps and reorganize them based on stories I had heard and my own memories. I set them aside over the next few years as she sank further into dementia. Now, a year after her death, I get them out again, read them over, comparing her memories to mine, hoping to reconcile them. My original intention was simply to edit her memoirs a bit and add a few comments and memories of my own. I soon realized that she had really left us just an outline of her life. I needed to write the memories more fully, flesh them out, add the story to her outline. This is a lot more work than I had hoped. and a section about the big house begins with a paragraph in her own writing. The big house. I wish I could have kept it, but I left Nicholson long ago. Memories, those I have, so many. The house is still sitting on top of a knoll with a winding driveway that everybody drives up now. The wooden terrace steps, how many of them? It was always a game to count, are gone. No one goes down to the road that way anymore. The croquet grounds that were a center of parties long ago are gone too. The mansard roof dates the house, and oh yes, so did the tin roof. On a strong rainy day, the drops sang a pleasant song, and the rainwater dripped down a pipe to the cistern in the cellar. These are my mother's words, reflections on her childhood home written sometime in her 80s. Memories of what was, remnants of what still remains, recollections of what she is so aware is no longer there. Nana and Granddad, my great-grandmother and great-grandfather, lived in the big house when I was a little girl. I remember them as a tall, thin, kindly couple. Claudia, my sister, informs me that Nada was not tall at all. In fact, she was quite short. So I get out the photo I have of them, with Nada leaning down to hold my little hand. Indeed, she does look short compared to Granddad. But I was 5 years old when they died. Everyone was tall to me. In the photo, we are standing just outside the back door of the big house, the house where my mother grew up, that continues to loom over her life, just as the bridge looms over the town. Mom repeats some of her initial description later on in her writing, interspersing the original with some additional details. The house stood rather majestically on top of a knoll and was landscaped with terraces down to the road, wooden steps going down the terraces, and a winding drive coming up the side of the house. It also had a level piece of ground, which was always referred to as the croquet ground, and another leveled off piece, which was called the clothes yard. Otherwise, the grounds were all rolling. A big three-story barn, an outhouse, and a chicken coop were in the back, and then woods. I can't for the life of me figure out where the croquet grounds would have been. The woods start barely several feet from the back door, and the front and side lawns all slope down from the house to the road. Definitely not possible for croquet. What my sister and I remember the most about the lawns at the big house are the huge rocks on the far side of the driveway. There were three or four of them, really big and quite far apart. Each rock would be the house for one of us and our cousins, and we would visit each other, running from one rock to another. It was so much fun. And the rocks were so big, humongous, really humongous, when I was two or three. How shocking to look at them now and see that they don't even reach my knees. The same rocks that my mother played on. Again, in her words. My early years at the big house were happy ones. As soon as I was able to walk freely, I had friends. The Potter girls, Portia and Alnita next door, near my age. They came to my house to play. Terraces to roll down, long wooden steps to run up and down, lots of open lawn with great big rocks to climb on. One is my house, another is yours. The exact same playing house, a generation apart.
We'll take a little, just a very short break to stretch if you need to, but I thought maybe you have a couple of questions that you might want to ask of the four wonderful readers who've just read. Any thoughts, any questions that you might have had? Huh? Well, so if you don't, I just want to sort of again point out how incredibly different the time period that each person has focused on, the quality of the memory, whether it's a sad memory or a sort of just more interested memory. Memoir is really a chance to sort of pick out whatever one has in life that one is trying to make sense of. And then, of course, Amanda with her weaving together of her mother's memories and her own memories and so on. So, 3-minute stretch break and then we'll keep going. Okay, we'll begin. Can you sit down so that we can begin part two of this lovely reading? And Diana and Priscilla, do you think you could let me?
Sorry. Does the microphone work now? Who knows, right?
If you get close, is it on?
Is it on?
Yes.
It's on, but you have to sort of be right by it.
Right by it, like that?
Yes.
All right, here we go. My name is Catherine Kiefer. I've been in this group for 4 years, I guess. This is an epistolatory attempt. Dear Diane, when you and I spoke 2 years ago, you said that your cancer had come back. I was quiet. Then I said, I will do anything that I can. I'll come to Vermont at least every 2 months, and more if it will help you. I said I would clean house, or clean your garage, garden for you or with you. We could kayak in the Connecticut River, or sit and knit. Whatever you wanted to do, I would do too. I would follow your lead. So began the journey. You asked two other friends to join on the way. The three of us made a team to make it possible for you to live at home and die at home. I do not know what it is to die. I do know what it is to be. I do know what it is like to be with someone who lives up until they decide to stop pushing away death. Death is huge. It gets bigger as it gets closer. It often sat in the room with us, but we each ignored it. You knew you were dying for months. You could tell that things were collapsing and failing and plugging up and withering. By the last 6 months, I was driving up to Vermont every 2 weeks for a night or two. We talked and knitted and drank cups of tea. I did just about everything with you, followed your lead. We went shopping, we talked, we cooked, we went through stuff. I cleaned and dusted your house. I always tried to make friends with a cat who was so cool and distant. She was dying too. She was 18. You became increasingly demanding. The steroids, we thought. You could be pretty sharp and grouchy. I found that if I just absorbed it and didn't offer resistance, the mood would collapse. I tried to become porous with no response. Just be soft and kind with you without condition. What do you want for supper? Do you want me to do a load of laundry? Do you want me to change the bed? Do you want me to go for a walk? Walk away and leave you so you can be alone. Every meal, I put the applesauce in the same cut glass dish. You took a certain pill that was hard to swallow and a mouthful of applesauce every morning and evening meal. It was a drug to stop the brain tumors from pressing on your vomit button. We gave you a full month and a half of being present without incessant throwing up. You wanted to live at home, to die at home, but to stay at home for all of it. The three of us were terrified that you would fall and break a bone, which would send us all to the hospital. You seemed so arrogantly frail. One day, when you and I came back from a series of errands, you walked down the driveway to the mailbox, waving me back. You began to uncoil and fell like a spring in a slow spin. You tore the knee out of your white jeans and bled a little. I helped you up, saying nothing. We bandaged the knee. I put the pants and the dirty clothes. We ate supper. You watched Dancing with the Stars, and I went to bed. You were often up a lot in the night. You could sleep in odd places, wherever you were sitting. I would find you in the morning, file or book open in your lap. When I found you, you never looked particularly comfortable, and you would be cool, too cool, as I touched you gently on the back of your neck. I would cover you with the blue fleece blanket. You ignored me, accepting the touch with a sigh. This morning, the morning after the fall, and after we had eaten breakfast, applesauce, pills, and all, I asked you about the trip to the mailbox. What was that all about? I don't want to lose my independence. I looked at you, and I went to the mailbox without you, the walker, or the two canes, to see if I could. You looked straight at me, and your look wanted to close the conversation. You raised your chin, lips together, softly, your blue eyes not blinking. I gently and firmly said, if you fall and break something, all bets are off. You probably will not be able to stay at home and be cared for by us as we play tag team. You'll go to the hospital. We will lose the control we now have. I stared back. My blue eyes did not blink. The hospital, I said. All bets are off became a phrase that you repeated fairly often. You died about a month later, but you died at home. You were standing in the kitchen with me, as I cleaned up after our breakfast. You pointed at the left-hand vegetable drawer for me to open. I laid out the drugs the hospice people had stashed there. Without your knowledge, it came out. These drugs changed permanently yours and my relationship with the hospice visitors. We no longer trusted them. They fell off a cliff and were not part of any discussion. Henceforth, they were in bed with the doctors, who had been dropped off the same cliff a month or two before. Drugs were not to be a part of your death, only morphine for pain. I became your advocate to defend you and guard you from the control of doctors and their assistants. You knew your drugs. You knew what you wanted. I, as your healthcare proxy holder, had to push the hospice people back in the box. They didn't know you. I did. They only came once a week. One of them cried every time she walked in the door. We had no sympathy and little interest in her. I did let them leave the antipsychotic syringe pack in the fridge with the morphine. One windy, cool day, before the leaves were out, we came back from a trip to Hanover. You had wanted to show me the urn you had selected for your ashes. We got out of your white matrix. You leaned back against the passenger door. We stood together. You looked at the sky. The sun was radiating out from behind the high, tumbling gray clouds. Shafts of light swept out in all directions. You looked at me. I'm going there. I'm not afraid. Our blue eyes did not blink. I walked to the mailbox and brought the contents to you. You looked at the supermarket flyer and the credit card bill. You handed the mail back to me. I won't have to pay that bill, you said with a soft smirk. We walked slowly to the house. I cooked two loin lamb chops, carefully and perfectly. They were pink, tender. The white plate also had asparagus and a new potato with butter. You looked at me and said, no more applesauce. Then I knew this was the last meal. You put your cloth napkin in your lap. You cut a piece of the chop, put it in your mouth. Delicious. A piece of asparagus. Delicious. That was it. That was all you ate. And with that, we were down to morphine only. No more applesauce. I washed the dishes. You prepared to die. You stopped sleeping in bed and moved to the futon in the living room to be near the wood stove. You wanted all your yarn and unfinished projects on the futon with you. You slept next to this beautiful pile of yarn. You smiled when you slept. You died with a smile. You were not afraid. 3 days after you died, we buried the cat in your garden. All my love, Kitty.